We're coming to the final session now. We're going to close the conference, the summit, the same way we opened it, and that is we're going to hear from young people, because we put young people at the center of what we're doing. So we have a moderator, Peter Materu, who is the Director of Youth Education and Learning and the Director of Youth Livelihoods at the MasterCard Foundation, will be on stage, and he has three special guests, young people, with him to talk about the conference. Peter, come on up. Please welcome.
Thank you very much, Roger. Did we have a good 2 days?
Yeah.
You feel good about the 2 days?
Yeah.
That's great. I know many of you already had an opportunity to talk to our young people who have been here, have been so fabulous. But we thought before we leave to go back to our homes, it would be good to have one more time the opportunity to hear from them what they have taken away from these 2 days. So I would like to you to join me to welcome on stage Agnes Hagan. Welcome, Agnes. John Ariel Choi. And Catherine Mloza. Agnes is a MasterCard Foundation scholar at the University of Cape Coast in Ghana. She's studying for a Bachelor of Science in Agriculture and wants to specialize in plant pathology. John is also a MasterCard Foundation scholar and currently at Earth University in Costa Rica. He's a co-founder of Save the Pastoralists initiative, which aims to improve pastoral life through agriculture in Kenya. Welcome, John. And Catherine specializes in communication for agricultural development. She works as an agricultural value chain officer with Farm Radio Trust, providing extension and advisory services to smallholder farmers in Malawi. Welcome, Catherine. I'm now going to sit and ask a few questions from these young people. What have they taken away from these 2 days of exciting discussions? Do we have microphones? Oh, yeah, sure. Thank you. Good. So I'm going to start with a question to all of you, very simple question, because you don't need to be convinced about agriculture. You all participate in agriculture one way or the other. And so my question is, what motivates you to work in the sector? And I'm going to start with you, Agnes.
Okay.
1 to 2 minutes, if you could share with us, what is it that motivates you in agriculture?
Okay, thank you very much. As I was growing as a young child, I used to go to the market with my mom. She's a trader who sells pepper. And then, you know, she gives farmers money to produce this pepper and then bring it back to her to sell. And most of the times, they bring the pepper and just the following day, you see the pepper rotten. Not did I only see that, but other farmers who bring foodstuffs to the market. Now, I became curious. What is making this pepper go bad? What is making them rot? Because farmers are complaining, my mother also complains, okay? And so with that, I started investigating what causes this pepper and other vegetables to rot. Now, I got to realize that initially I wanted to be a nurse to treat human beings. But then I realized that plants get sick. Now, human beings, when are sick, they walk to the hospital to see a doctor. But plants cannot walk. They cannot talk. So if they are sick, how are they going to tell the farmers that I'm sick? If they are being inflicted with insects and pathogens, how are they going to tell them? And so I took the challenge upon myself. No, I'm going to study about this plant. Right. I'm really going to be a plant doctor. I'm going to learn about their physiology, how the various activities that goes on within this plant. Right. And when they are sick, I will be a voice for the plant. And so I decided to be a plant pathologist. And that was
excellent.
It.
So we now know what it means, a doctor for plants. Excellent. John.
I'm going to tell a simple story of how I get into agriculture. I was born in South Sudan, and then when there was war, so we moved to Kenya, and we lived in a refugee camp. My uncle was our neighbor, used to grow groundnuts. So at the time we would sleep without food, my sister would go and steal the groundnuts. So one day he caught us and called us with the hand and come to our house and say, teach your children how to farm, told my mother. So my mom started a small farm and told us, now take care of it so that your neighbors don't come and steal your vegetables. So from there, we started taking care of vegetables. That's when I learned, get interested in agriculture, so that you don't come and steal my vegetables. So, and I got interest, I got a chance to go to a prestigious university, other university. We transformed 400 youth to speak one language, that's agriculture. So I was the goat among the sheep. So I decided to be the sheep, which is mad in agriculture. So I'm among those people who are inspired and addicted to agriculture. That's how I came into agriculture field. Thank you.
Thank you. Catherine, what motivates you?
My dad is a professor in agriculture, and he met my mom in college. They were both studying agriculture. My elder sister was in the same agricultural college, and I went to the same agricultural college. However, I wanted to drop out in my second year. I just hated my course. But then I realized that I had wanted to do communication initially. And I noted that not a lot of people in science are able to communicate that science. And by my fourth year, I actually figured out a way to make agriculture work for me. I bragged to my friends that I get paid for doing what I love, which is helping people to communicate science. So that's what motivates me every day. I've worked for 5 years. I love my job because I do what I love.
Very good. Excellent. Excellent. So now we've had these 2 days of exciting discussions. We've had a lot of wonderful things. No agriculture for the youth, but without the youth and so on and so forth. For you, was there a particular session in the last 2 days that stood out for you?
Yeah. Especially the first day, that was yesterday, the youth transformation section, that was when Leticia and her colleagues were on stage. You know, when they were talking about their story or their success story in agriculture, I was just sitting there and I was so challenged because Leticia, at the age of 14, as young as she was, could bring up this initiative without anyone supporting her at the initial stage. And the other young women and guys who also spoke, it really challenged me. And it just got me thinking that if at this young age they could do something like this, then what am I doing? It means I've got a lot to do. And so I was just sitting there, I was so amazed, and just especially with Plirani. She lost both parents, but that didn't put her down. Mm-hmm. You see, in Ghana, you see most people walking around begging for money or food, with the conception that my mother and my parents are dead, I don't have anything to do. But that didn't put her down. And so I believe that as youth, as we are growing, there is nothing, there are so many opportunities, there are so many things that we can do. And so that section really got me up, and I was really impressed.
Very good.
Thank you. Any?
I think for me, the session that stood out so clearly, mm-hmm. and I love it, is when Dr. Wanjiru and Dr. Lindiwe confessed at the age that agriculture is for the youth. They accept, finally accept. For example, Dr. Lindiwe said that nothing for the youth without the youth.
Yeah.
And then we had Dr. Wanjiru saying, inclusion, who is to be included? Mm. Us. So I think it's high time the elders should give us a chance, like what John Bosco said. But I think taking over is a bad word in Africa. I think the bad word is inherit. It sounds respectable. I think when I say inherit from African father, it sounds respectable. So I think it's high time our elders, let us inherit. Though mm-hmm. you're still alive, let us inherit. So let us inherit Africa. But we'll do it in a democratic way. I have two ways I think we can do it. One, policy. When you put policies like, for example, land. In Africa, land is not for the youth. It's for elders. So we give policies that allow youth to access land. So my dad said that, John, my land is not for farming. I'll go and access land. I can do farming. Another one is loans. For example, youth are not allowed to get loans. Only my father can get a loan on my behalf. So you say that, no, John, I'm not taking any loan for you. I can access loan. Mm. So that means that I have taken, I have inherited from him democratically. Another way is technology. We all know that you old people, you don't know technology. Okay, my dad did technology 1 year ago, and he's still asking me to help him on Facebook. So I think if we all show the elders that there's technology we can use in agriculture, they'll say, yes, it's good. They'll say, okay, how do you do it? We show them, they'll understand and say, okay, now do it. Mm-hmm. That means that we have taken over. Mm-hmm. So I think those are two sessions that show for me.
Wonderful. Thank you. Catherine?
I think a lot of things stood out for me, but the one that struck a chord is the Minister of Rwanda for Youth and ICT, who said something that was quite profound to me, that we need to put a stop to African problems running parallel to African solutions. Mm-hmm. And just recently, Madam Ruth actually mentioned that it's not that we don't have resources, it's not that we don't have money. Africa has all that, but somehow the money doesn't go where it's supposed to go. Mm. And I think based on these two speakers, you'd see that we basically are the solution for change. I'm personally tired of discussing problems. I'm a mover, I'm a shaker. I want us to see action. Mm-hmm. And I believe that young people basically are the fulcrum for that in the decade to come. So I'm looking forward to actually moving up the ladder so that I can change things.
Very good. Thank you. Now, You've all tried to do something in agriculture, and you probably have faced some barriers in moving forward. And my next question is, what are those barriers? And what message would you like to send to us here, to your colleagues, your fellow young people, to the governments, the private sector, to development organizations? What message would you like to send to them so that you can resolve those barriers that you've experienced or you see ahead of you? Who would like to start?
I'll start.
You want to start? Yeah, please, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. As I said earlier on, you know, when I wanted to become a nurse, you know, and in Ghana, one profession that people, my fellow Ghanaians can attest to that they see they have eyes for is nursing. They just love to nurse. That's all that they want to see. Right. And, you know, when I decided to do agriculture, when I went to the secondary school, mm-hmm. initially we were about 35 and about 15 girls. But as we were moving on, they asked us that if you want to change your course, you can just submit your name and they will just process it. And all the ladies went except two of us. And, in fact, I was kind of, why? Why are ladies not so much interested in agriculture? Mm. And this came, even my family, they were discouraging me from pursuing agriculture. They were kind of, Agnes, why not do science so that you can go to the medical field or become a nurse or something like that? But then, I don't know, I had become so much interested in agric, especially with that aspect of pathology, knowing much about the diseases and the pest aspect, that nothing could just put me off. And so this was a challenge that I faced both from the family and even from friends. Even at school, the fact that we're just two ladies in class was just enough reason for people to criticize us, just always laughing at us and teasing us. So, but then it was a challenge, but then I was not put down. Yeah. And even furthering on to the university, in my class, initially we were about 150, and it was just 10 girls and 140 guys. And you see, if you're a lady and you are in such a class at times, especially as smallish as I am, you always feel kind of intimidated. And it's funny because even at the SHS in my class, I was the shortest and cutest. Even at the university, the same thing. And people were always kind of laughing at you. But, you know, if you really have the passion for something, though it might look like a challenge, but then you'd see that challenge as a stepping stone just to move higher. And so one message that I would like to put across, okay, is I've forgotten the brain behind this saying, but it says that the real act of discovery lies not in finding new lands, but then seeing with a different eyes. And I believe that throughout this section, now the youth, the government, and private sectors are now seeing the youth with a different eyes, mm-hmm. especially with women, because women also have a role to play in transforming agriculture. That is my message.
Thank you. John?
Okay, we're trying to implement a simple project in northern Kenya, which is an area that's affected by drought. And our big problem we have is we're trying to tell pastoralists that you guys can do farming alongside the lifestyle of pastoralism. It's so hard to convince them. It's very hard. Telling somebody, you guys, okay, you know what? You can have your animals at the same time you have vegetables. It's very hard. I think that's the biggest challenge we have. And it's high time we start saying that agriculture is a lifestyle. It's no longer, how do you call it, something you can choose. It's a lifestyle. All of us should live that culture of agriculture. It should be something that we all of us do for living, for leisure. Anything we want to do is agriculture. So the message I would like to take across, and the government should also implement and preach to the countries, that agriculture is a lifestyle. Let's all of us have the same lifestyle. Let's all of us practice agriculture.
Very good. Thank you.
I think one of the major problems that I have faced is that I think young women are taken like flowers in a vase in the professional ranks, that is. We are pretty to look at pretty girls with pretty brains, but when it comes to a policy meeting, you find that you invite the executive director, the director of programs, the director of this, and you don't necessarily consider these young people who are coming up and have something either to contribute, or they might not necessarily contribute, but they can learn. And I really tried much as possible to show or to hone myself to be able to participate in policy making or policy decisions or what have you, so that I should, at least there should be not only a presence of a woman, but a young woman who can contribute to these things. Am I supposed to learn this when I'm the AU commissioner and I'm 45 or I'm 55? I can actually learn it right now. So I really feel that has been the major challenge that I have been facing.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you. I think many people have said here the most valuable thing in this summit has been the presence of young people participating as equals. So you're absolutely right. Now, I'm going to ask you in one sentence, just one thing. If you were to think of one thing that you want to take forward as the next step for you, what could that be? Very briefly, what could that be?
Okay, one thing that I would like to take forward is mentoring young women to unleash the potentials in them, especially in the field of agriculture, because I believe that young women have so much that they can offer.
So mentoring your fellow young women.
Yes.
Very good. John?
One thing is, youth involvement in agriculture is no longer a vision, it's an action. So she's taking action. So don't leave the vision, let's take an action. It's a longer vision. It's an action.
Very good. And Catherine?
I think I share with Agnes, mentoring young women, especially in a country like Malawi. We need that.
Uh-huh. Mm. Very good. Excellent. Now is your chance to ask me or to ask the audience any question you may have. Anyone has a question to ask? Who would like to start? John?
Okay. Okay. I have one question. I know all of us, we're going to take out something from here. We have agreements, we have agreed, we have listened, we have learned. How do we ensure that what we have learned is reaching to those people who have not a chance, who have not got a chance to come here? I know we will try to get people we can get to, but as a MasterCard, how do we ensure that the people that we're not going to reach, we will reach the message?
Right.
That's my question.
Thank you. I think that's a very important question for all of us, right? One thing is, we are going to produce a report that is going to go on the website, and everybody who is here and who is not here can see. Secondly, our programming going forward is going to take these messages very seriously, because we are developing a new strategy, The new strategy is going to focus on youth employment, and the ideas that came up in these discussions are going to be very useful to the foundation in shaping the messages and the programs and our new strategy. But thirdly, and this is very important for every one of us here, I think we are the ambassadors to take this message out. And first and foremost, the young people who are here, there is nothing more effective as you going and saying, look, everybody believes in us. People out there are saying that we are the drivers of this of transformation in agriculture, and I would say socio-economic transformation in Africa. And we are being trusted now as equals, equal participants in the process of making this transformation happen. I think you are the best ambassadors for this message, and I would urge everybody here to see himself or herself like that.
Someone who has one foot in the university, because I also lecture part-time in the communication department within the University of Malawi, one thing I don't like is the learning models that we have within our universities, especially in Africa. They are quite rigid, and they evaluate you more on what you have picked up throughout the semester than what you actually know and can apply. Mm. What are the prospects for MasterCard to actually start to influence the education system within Africa? Because I think most of what we're doing can actually have a multiplier effect if we also start to influence beyond the agricultural sector, for instance, the education sector.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you very much. I don't know how much you know about the MasterCard Foundation Education Program, but we do have a large scholars program that supports young people at secondary and tertiary level to access quality education. We focus on young people from disadvantaged families who would otherwise not get the chance, even if they're talented, to get the chance. So to access quality secondary and tertiary education. But within that, we have a very strong leadership development component so that these young people emerge not only as well-trained young people, but they emerge as leaders in their communities and in their countries. Now, we have about 35,000 scholarships committed for that so far, mostly secondary. And increasingly, we are bringing in African institutions. Now, one of the things that we're planning to do going forward is to leverage the partners we have already in the North, in the United States, in Canada, in Europe, in Costa Rica, to leverage these partners who are stronger to work with African institutions so that we can raise the bar. The issues of curriculum you raised, but also issues of leadership and governance within institutions, and to model what we are trying to do under the Scholars Program so that many more students can benefit from this. So this is our thinking going forward, to move it one notch up from influencing and benefiting individuals only to benefiting individuals plus institutions. So that's the future that is coming. Please join me in, again, thanking Agnes, John, and Catherine for this wonderful sharing that we have had here. And please. For each one of us, let's take the message out into the world, other young people. If you're from government to your colleagues in government, you're from the private sector to your colleagues in the private sector, if you are from development partners to the colleagues in the development community, wherever you come from, that young people are here, they're equal participants, and they're ready to lead transformation of agriculture in Africa, and in fact, social economic transformation in Africa. Thank you. I now like to thank you all very much for this wonderful engagement that we've had here. I know you had to leave behind a lot of things that were competing for time to be here. And I think your presence has been the main ingredient to the success that we have registered in this summit. I would also like to thank a number of people and teams that have made this possible. Our advisory committee, which has contributed a lot in helping to shape what we have delivered together here. The organizing team, which has done a wonderful job working in the front office and in the back office to make everything work well until this moment. The speakers. And here I want to specifically thank Madam High Excellency Rhoda Dumusime from the Africa Union, the Honorable Minister Jean-Philbert Nsengimana, did I pronounce it correctly? the Minister of Youth and ICT of Rwanda for gracing us with his presence at the opening session. I'd like also to thank Professor Ruth Onyango, who just spoke to us, for really sharing with us some very exciting messages that really give us good food for thought. The members of our board who are here with us, Jendai Fraser and Doug, I don't know, thank you very much for joining us here. Very important, our youth, who have been such a major, have provided such a major input to this conference. They've really made this summit such an enjoyable and resourceful event. We would like to express very special thanks to you for your participation and for your contributions in the way that you have contributed without any fear, with very open minds, and also challenging us to do better going forward. That is extremely useful. And on our part, as the MasterCard Foundation, we want to continue to do this. Perhaps someday, one of these summits will be run by young people only. There will only be sessions for young people, and the rest of us will sit and wait and hear from you. Let me also thank you all for being present once again. Thank our crew from the media who have been very helpful in making sure that the messages which are coming out of this summit do not just stay in this room, but are going all to all people, other young people, but others out there who are trying to do something about the youth employment agenda. And within this also our own communication team from the foundation, which has done a very good job in sending out the messages to all our community out there, and also have played a big role in pulling together all the messages that were shared with you here. And finally, let me also thank the Marriott Hotel and all the workers here who have made our stay here possible and have supported us so that this day was comfortable for all of us. So thank you all very much. I would like now to hand over to Roger for the final closing moments. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Peter. I just have a few final comments. A couple of people came to me today and said that we haven't done enough clicker questions today. There's only during the debate, so that you would like, apparently, another clicker question. So we have organized a clicker question for you. It's going to be on the screen any moment there. There it is. Don't click yet, but we want to try and get a sense, do you have a better understanding today than you did yesterday about how youth in Africa can drive agricultural transformation? Have you got your clickers in your hands? Are you ready to vote one last time? Yes, you have four choices. Voting is open. Please indicate your choice. One, two, three, four. Do you understand? Do you have a better awareness today than you did yesterday? Or actually, a better awareness than when you first walked in the door yesterday? All right. This is not hard, right? The voting is closed. And the results are much closer. All right. Fantastic. So all of you who voted much closer, that is the right answer, all right? And for everybody else, we'll have another clicker session tomorrow. You can come back and we'll do it again, all right? Listen, there are, Peter thanked a number of people who participated and were responsible for the work we've been doing for the last couple of days. I wanted to signal and for you to recognize one other group. If you remember yesterday morning, I asked all of the youth delegates to stand up at the beginning, and we recognized the youth delegates. But what you may not know is that there were a number of mentors who were working with those youth delegates. We have people who volunteered their time, graciously volunteered their time, and shared their experience. Some of them were working with the youth delegates about this conference, how to navigate the conference, how to network, how to talk to other people, that sort of thing. And there's another group of mentors who will be working with the youth delegates through the rest of the year to offer them some advice from time to time about how they're making progress in their careers, in their studies. So I'd like to ask all of the mentors to please stand up, and if we could recognize, please stand up, the ones who worked, and if we could recognize. Thank you. So thank you very much again. That's really quite gracious and very kind of you to do that. Surveys. When we plan these conferences at the foundation, we like to know what you think, obviously. What worked, what didn't work, which sessions did you like, which sessions did you like a little less. I hope there's not many of those. So you will be getting surveys. The surveys will be available on your guidebook app later this afternoon. You could fill it out there. Or you can look in your email inbox. They should be coming in the next couple of days, I believe. So either way, whether you want to do it on the guidebook app or whether you want to do it on the email, if you prefer that, please respond to the survey. Please tell us what you think. And please tell us what you think we should do the next time we do a summit on Young Africa Work. So we really do. The surveys are read. Trust me, there is a team of people in Toronto. I know they are read and they are analyzed. And we do take into account what you say. So please fill out those surveys. Final thing, Twitter. There's been a fantastic conversation. I'm not quite sure who's been tweeting here. I've just been reading a lot of tweets that have been come out. As Peter said, the messages we want to express are not just for the people in this room, but people in a much larger community in other parts of Africa and other parts of the world. So keep using that hashtag. The conversation does not end because we end the conference. Keep using the hashtag, YAW2017. And keep monitoring that to see what the conversation is like. And finally, I just wanted to say personally, you know, remember when you leave here, when you get on your planes or get in your cars to drive home and you're back in your hometowns, I'd like you to remember that when you think about the transformation of agriculture in Africa, when you think about the theme that we've been talking about for the last 2 days, and when you think about the future of African agriculture, please remember, I think, that you have seen that future in this room for the last 2 days. And I think we can all agree the future is in good hands. These are the people, this is the future of African agriculture, and I think it's in good hands. So you've been a fantastic audience. Thank you for participating. Thank you for applauding and encouraging all the speakers. And I wish you safe travels, and have a good afternoon, and have a good day. Okay.